Time.
It's like a new pair of underwear. At first it's constrictive, but after a while it becomes a part of you.
Together they're bringing you the best in Oklahoma State sports talk and their opinions on sports topics from around the country.
That's right. Listen up. Hey, listen up. You.
Patrick Wheeler.
Let's stomp these dudes.
And Zach Lancaster.
Everyone is stupid except me.
This is the Afternoon Sports Drive on the Triple Play Sports Radio Network.
That's what I'm talking about. Sports!
Show me where the mic is. I'm on stage, black shirt, and my Tim's. You know how I do it. I ain't playing with you. I've been grinding. Anybody trying to sleep on me, better do something with your eyelids. I hear a lot of whining, but I don't hear a lot of rhyming. Whoa! Everybody got opinions. Let it go into my ear, then I block that. Put me on stage, I'ma rock that. Saying you the best. Stop that, phony. I am not that.
Welcome in to the Afternoon Sports Drive on the Triple Play Sports Radio Network with Patrick Wheeler and Zach Lancaster, live from the Triple Play Sports Radio studios here in Stillwater, Oklahoma. I made it in. It wasn't pretty. The weather is not good, as everybody knows. But it is, Zach, by the way, a nice, it's warmed up a lot today. It started off, you know, in the negatives and it got down to 0 degrees, and now it's what, a piping hot 4 degrees here in Stillwater, Oklahoma.
Oh, man.
Yeah, feels great. And so I'm hoping you haven't completely frozen out yet. Oklahoma State got a win over Kansas State on Saturday. Wasn't pretty by any means, but we're going to get into that. At least it was a win. Then you have a lot more stuff coming out of the Deshaun Watson story. We'll get more on him later on. A really crazy finish in the Daytona 500 this weekend that we'll get mainly Zach's thoughts on. I know he's the big race guy, but I did pay attention to the end of that race, and that was pretty wild. That's what you want, a Daytona 500, so we'll get to that too coming up here on the Afternoon Sports Drive. First, taking a look at Kansas State and Oklahoma State over the weekend. It was pretty wild, to say the least, in that game because of the twists and turns that ultimately happened. I think we have Zach back. Is that you, Zach?
Yeah.
There he is.
I thought you guys lost power. I can't get to the sideline, so I'll do this for a little bit.
All right, there we go. I was just saying, I hope that you didn't freeze out on us yet.
No, yeah, so I thought about it. It's, you know, I'm looking here at the weather, and it's supposed to jump up to 21 on Wednesday.
Ooh.
And I don't know if I've ever been as excited for 21 degree weather in a really, really long time. Like 21 Wednesday, 23 Thursday. Ooh, are you ready for this?
I'm ready.
40 on Saturday.
Oh, that might as well be summer. I can't wait.
47 on Sunday. Oh my God, it just keeps getting better.
All right, I'm pumped up for that. It's going to be good stuff coming up this weekend. So we just got to get through these next couple of days, and then we can all thaw out, and it should be good stuff. All right, so let's take a look at Oklahoma State, Kansas State over the weekend.
Yeah.
Early Saturday morning game, and through the first half of that game, it kind of went what I was hoping in terms of, okay, Oklahoma State's going to dominate a game here. And they're gonna go into halftime with a solid lead over a not so good Kansas State team, but ultimately things end up pretty sloppy. You have to tighten up, as we know, right? Things just have to tighten up at this point. Turnovers are the main thing. Another issue that we talked about going into this game, and nothing changed there. You know, you were up 20 in the second half, and I'll admit, I never once felt comfortable. I mean, that's where I am with this team. That is where I am, even against Kansas State. And lo and behold, Kansas State comes back. But don't get it twisted. It wasn't Kansas State getting back into it. It was Oklahoma State letting them get back into it, right? I mean, when you go on you let Kansas State, a team that can barely score, go on a 16-0 run. Like, that's where your issue lies. Because coming up, Iowa State, you can get away with that, but that's it. The rest of the teams on this schedule, yeah, that's not going to be able to work. And so in the second half, and we were talking during the game, I was like, here we go again. It's the same thing, not just in terms of losing the lead, but Cade not doing anything in the first half. Then he shows up in the second, and against Kansas State, what he did was good enough. You know, he hits a three, and they regain control in that second half. And the rest of the way, they're able to maintain that. But they should have won by 30. I mean, plain and simple, they should have won by 30. And at this point, you just so desperately want them to deliver a knockout blow. That's the thing. You love a win. You appreciate a win. It's great to get back in the win column. But think how good this team would be, or maybe even the next step they could take if they could really start delivering those knockout punches. When you go into halftime with a really solid lead, you get up 20. That's something that you should be able to keep going the rest of the game. But it's one of those games, again, Zach, where it just didn't happen. Ultimately, the Oklahoma State comes away with it. But I don't know about you. This is one of the few teams left that they can get away with something like that.
Yeah, and, you know, looking at, you know, just going through, you know, what they've done in the last 3 to 4 games, I don't even know if it's a – I hesitated to call it a gimme game earlier, and I really don't think it's a gimme game now. I mean, you've got, you know, Iowa State has 4 players averaging double-digit points. You've had at least 2 or 3 players that have scored double digits in the last 3 or 4 games, and if you're curious about that, 2 of those were against Kansas, and then there was 1 in there against Oklahoma. So it's not like they've been playing a bunch of scrubs. And you go back to that Kansas State game, you know, and you look at the first half, and it was fantastic. You know, held Kansas State to 19 points in the first half. The first four minutes of the second half, Kansas State went on an 18-3 run, including a 4-plus-minute scoring drought for Oklahoma State. You can't do that. You cannot allow a team like Kansas State, or, you know, coming up on Tuesday, tomorrow afternoon against Iowa State, you can't allow that. You can't allow any team to do that. But, you know, I felt comfortable, you know, the last 3 or 4 games, because they weren't allowing those giant runs like they were. And then all of a sudden you break out to a 16-0, and then before it was all said and done, an 18-3 run, and there were multiple 3-plus-minute scoring drops. I think Oklahoma State ended the game with like 3.5 minutes without hitting a field goal. You know, you can't do that. You can't give up 15-plus turnovers in a game. Now, granted, they forced, I think, 14, 15 on the other end, but, I mean, that's not going to get it done. You're absolutely right. Oklahoma State should have won by 30. You know, and when Kansas State was going on that run, you could tell, like, okay, this team – you know, they haven't, you know, I think that was their, what, 11th or 12th straight loss. You know, they hadn't won since December, and the conference game was early December the last time they won. And so they were desperate. They desperately wanted it. And I think this Kansas State team moving forward is going to be really dangerous, because they're a young and talented team. They just don't have it right now. And you could see glimpses of that during that 16-0 run. But Oklahoma State is too good of a team to go on 4-plus-minute scoring drought. You know, if you're going to allow a team, you know, not even allow, but, like, I can buy giving up 16 points in the first, you know, 4 minutes of the second half if, on the other end, Oklahoma State is putting up equal points. That's the big thing to me.
Yeah, no, I completely agree. And that's – I appreciate the win, right? I mean, we both do. That's
sure.
Great.
Absolutely.
But I'm looking ahead, because Oklahoma State is squarely in the tournament mix. You know, right now they for sure are in this tournament mix. And so I'm looking ahead to that and thinking all this is great and whatever. We get to the postseason. I mean, do they want to stick around in the postseason? Because if you do, these two things have to – you got to get past it. And we're beating a dead horse, because it happens every single week, where we talk about turnovers, and then we talk about Oklahoma State giving up runs, not being able to score for long periods of time. And it's like you said, that's what's so frustrating about it, is that they have so much talent, and there's so many places to get production from scoring the basketball on this team. There really is. And that was one of the biggest highlights of this team coming into this season. Never once said that I would be worried about any of the offensive production, because there was so much potential talent here, and it wasn't just Cade. You know, you had Isaac coming in. Now, we didn't know how well Rondell was going to play. That's been a huge spark. Bryce has stepped up. There's been a lot of good guard play here. But, man, I understand, too. You're going to have – when a team like Oklahoma State wants to run like they do, you're going to have turnovers, plain and simple. You are. But not that many. And a lot of them, again, unforced. That's the biggest thing. So until this becomes something that Oklahoma State fixes – I'm not counting on them to make any type of a deep postseason run in the only year that they're going to have Cade Cunningham. That's the main thing I remember as well. You know, try to remember going in the rest of the way this season. Don't you want to do, you know, get as far as you can while you have the number one player in the country? I mean, it's kind of now or never. And these are types of things that really good teams and the best teams in the country tighten up by now. And it's like you said, it is good that they were able to force almost just as many, right, on the defensive end. But that's simply because, look, Nigel Pack played really pretty well. But he was their best player. I mean, and coming back in, there's not. I agree that there's some talent on that Kansas State team, and the future might be bright eventually. But they did not look like a team that belonged on the same court with Oklahoma State for the most part. And OSU let them look that way towards the latter part of that second half. But you know,
you know, and you talk about those turnovers.
Yeah.
You know, with Cade, the number one overall player. You know, and there's no question that Cade is one of the best basketball players in the country. You know, top five. In college basketball, there's no question about that. I mean, he's leading the Big 12 in scoring. You know, he's averaging almost six and a half rebounds a game. He's shooting 43% from the field. He's shooting 43% from three. He's shooting 85% from the line. You know, but you look at these games. He had five turnovers against West Virginia. The least amount of turnovers he's had since January was two against Kansas State January 9th. He had four against Kansas, four against Arkansas, four against TCU, six against Texas, seven against Kansas, and then five again this last weekend. Turnovers are an issue, but turnovers are an issue for Cunningham.
Yeah.
He has got to get those cleaned up because those are unforced turnovers. You know, it's not like he's getting his pocket picked or he's collecting charges or anything like that. He's taking sloppy dribbles and sloppy passes.
Well, and part of that to me comes with sort of the mindset that some of these top players have, which is, you know what, I turn the ball over, so what? I'll get it back and I'll score. You know, and I don't think that's necessarily every time that Cade turns it over, because sometimes he's trying to be over aggressive. I get that. And then there's sometimes where he's trying to take it against three defenders and he loses the ball. You know, so you want a balance. But what I did see out of him, you know, he ends up scoring what, 15 points on 13 shots or whatever it was there. I mean, that's pretty efficient. But the best part about Cade's game, if you watch, there's always one or two, sometimes even three specific times during a game you can look back and say, that's what makes him different. That's next level, because he's either taking a tough shot that a lot of guys aren't going to make, he's making an incredible pass like he did in that game against Kansas State, or there's just always these flashes that show you why he's the best player on the floor all the time. If you could manage to get a full game worth of production, and I'm talking like where he's not having to score 22 and finishing with most of those in the second half, you know, where he's putting on a display, scoring the ball, getting easier looks all the way throughout. That's when, and that could very well happen coming in the Big 12 tournament down the stretch. He might end up playing his best, even better than he has in the regular season down the stretch, as most great players do. So obviously he had some bright spots. I thought the other bright spot was Rondell again.
Absolutely.
You know, he played well in his first start. You and I talked about that Ice probably wouldn't play. And he ended up not playing, which I understood that for sure with the foot issue. You want to get that healed up as quick as possible. So you get Rondell in there. And he had a number of actually great three-point chances in his corners that he loves, as you talked about on Friday, that didn't quite go down on some of them. But, man, he brought the energy that team needed, right? 10 points is all great and everything. But the energy he brought and some of the defensive plays he made, that's the Rondell Walker you really, really like to see.
Well, yeah, I mean, you look at his first half, you know, he had the steal in the alley-oop to Cade.
Yep.
There in the second half, that big and one opportunity there. The first 4 minutes of the game, Rondell was 5 points. He had two steals. You know, I mean, that 10 points, six rebounds on the game, three steals. That's what you want from a freshman. You know, and we've seen that all season long from Rondell. You know, He's provided that spark off the bench. He's provided that spark now as a starter on Saturday. And the way Iowa State has been playing, I don't know if you're going to see Ice or not. I think there's probably a better chance tomorrow that, you know, than the Kansas State game of seeing Ice. But I would expect Rondell to get a good bulk playing time against the Cyclones, but that's what you want. You know, there aren't many offensive players that love to play defense, you know, especially freshmen. You typically don't get that. And he's that stalwart. He's that spark plug on both ends. It's going to get you an impressive steal, or, you know, he's going to a little rusty as of late, but he'll nail you a big corner three to, you know, to get the crowd on its feet. And I expect him to get a, with that game on Saturday, I honestly expect him to get a pretty decent amount moving forward.
Yeah, and you know, the other thing, Zach, that I thought was, I guess I would consider it mostly a disappointment, you know, Caleb Boone scoring, not good, right? Non-factor. But the rebounds were good. I mean, he did have production there. But it goes back to one of those things where it's like, what if? What if Oklahoma State had a consistent big man down there that gave them a solid performance every single game? How good would this team be, right? They're like a couple pieces away, whether that's not turning the ball over or getting production from their big men. They're right there. And Caleb, I thought, had a good chance to really have a nice day against Kansas State, and that was with MA still a little limited. And he wasn't able to do anything, really. I mean, rebounding was good, and that's it. Wasn't able to score. Luckily, Oklahoma State was able to kind of key, you know, make sure they got points elsewhere. But bottom line for me, while this is a win, it's great, and I'm happy for Oklahoma State. They needed this win to get back on track. It's not a performance they can feel good about overall, because they know that if they put that type of performance up against any other team besides Iowa State left on the schedule, it's not going to go that way.
No, and that's where it's tricky, you know, because, you know, you look at what Kansas State and Iowa State has done in the past week or so. You know, Kansas State gave Texas a run for its money. OU nearly went to Norman and upset OU. I think early last week or late last or the week before. But in terms of optics, right? Iowa State's lost 10 in a row. They are struggling. And Iowa and Kansas State, they were struggling. You know, and Kansas State, they hit that bucket late to make it a 7-point game, I think, 67-60 there at the end. Oklahoma State needs to have a similar first half against Iowa State as they did against Kansas State. And then if they're able to do that, that'll give them a chance to really work on that second half. Because Oklahoma State, they need, just optically, you know, they need to beat Iowa State by at least 10. You know, even if it comes down to it and Oklahoma State hits the bucket late, Oklahoma State needs to beat Iowa State by double digits. You know, they're the first team out of the AP top 25. I think they're 4 points. Behind that 25th place team, I think it's important, and it's going to be tough, right? You got the toughest stretch of basketball coming up. You got two against OU, may or may not have one against West Virginia. You got a tough one against Baylor on the road. You got Texas Tech at home. Those are some of the toughest teams in the country. I think it'll be tough to stay. You know, I think if they beat Iowa State, and they play really, really well against Baylor, I think there's a chance they could, you know, sneak back into the top 25 depending on what happens. But I think it's important that the Cowboys play some of their best basketball. I think it's important. It's a bit obvious. But I think that it's very important that they play some of their best basketball these last four or five games and try to limit turnovers, because it's going to be important to have the best optics possible going into the Big 12 tournament and going into the NCAA tournament.
Don't forget, tomorrow, as Zach said, the game has been moved up with Iowa State at 3 o'clock, so they'll tip off right when we come on the air. We'll have it live in here and break it down as it happens. Should be a lot of fun to do that for once. And then, of course, Zach, as well, we get the news today, right, that one of the Bedlam games has a different date.
Yeah, I was a little surprised when they first announced it, but it makes sense. They moved the Bedlam game that's scheduled for Stillwater. That was Thursday, February 25th. They've bumped that back to March 1st. They moved it to Big Monday. It's either going to be on ESPN or ESPN2 at 8. With the way OU is playing, you know, and the way Oklahoma State has played down the stretch, ESPN, man, they want Oklahoma, who's a top 10 team right now, and they want Cade Cunningham on their, you know, on their channels as much as possible. I mean, that's why they moved the Texas Tech game next Monday. That's why they moved it from Tuesday to Monday to put it on Big Monday, because they want those big, big-time matchups. So Oklahoma State, OU in Stillwater, March 1st, 8 p.m.
Mark your calendars accordingly. Get them on Twitter at ZLancaster91. I'm at ThePattyWheels. When we come back here on the Afternoon Sports Drive, well, Friday, we mentioned one team that Deshaun Watson said he might want to go to. At least it was reported that way. Now we have a different idea as the saga continues. We'll tell you where he might end up coming up next. Show today brought to you by Furniture Showcase. Downtown 5th and South Main here in Stillwater. Stillwater's mattress store there since 1982. Furniture Showcase, you can shop online at stillwaterfurnitureshowcase.com. Back after this. You can call till your voice is running out. Welcome back in Afternoon Sports Drive, Triple Play Sports Radio Network. Patrick Wheeler and Zach Lancaster. Show today brought to you by Furniture Showcase. Downtown of 5th and South Main, Stillwater's mattress store since 1982. Big names in mattresses, so you'll get the best sleep of your life every single night. Sealy, Ashley, Serta, Stearns & Foster, Tempur-Pedic, along with many others, and their famous dual adjustable sets are all available at Furniture Showcase. Check them out on the web at StillwaterFurnitureShowcase.com. Patrick Wheeler and Zach Lancaster here on the Afternoon Sports Drive. So on Friday, I believe, Zach, correct me if I'm wrong, but we mentioned on Friday about Deshaun Watson possibly talking about going to the New York Jets, correct?
That would be correct.
My, how a couple of days go by and more news comes out. This thing is like the way that it continues to go. And what I'm starting to think is with all this news about where he's going to go and what he's going to do, that by the time it all rolls around, we might just see him staying with the Houston Texans. I mean, couldn't you see that being the ending to all this? We're just like, I'm just going to stick around. I'm not going to go anywhere.
Yeah, it's gonna be weird, especially with everything coming out about him, you know, saying that he's very willing to not play next year. That he's, yeah, you know what, if they don't want to get rid of me, I'm willing to sit on the bench and just eat that money and not get paid until they decide they want to get rid of me. So, like, I think a lot would have to happen, but the way things are going, I wouldn't surprise me if they were able to get it all ironed out and all of a sudden, you know, August rolls around and you see Deshaun trotting out there on that practice field. What they need to do, I'll tell you right now, is they need to go ahead and just lock Houston in for Hard Knocks this year. Because
yes,
it would be the most entertaining Hard Knocks ever created.
Oh, man, it really would. It was good. It was already good a couple years ago when they had to document Antonio Brown with the Raiders. Yeah. And, you know, he had the whole helmet thing and everything else that was going on. That was wild.
It would blow that out of the water.
Yeah.
Especially if you're able to get Deshaun to be candid and you're able to get the GM to be candid, or the president, whoever the guy is that doesn't know what he's doing. If you're able to really get all parties involved, especially, I know he's been released, but especially if you could get like a cameo from J.J. Watt to sit down and be like, listen, this is why I requested a trade. Like, depending on how this whole thing, you know, settles out, within the next 10 to 15 years, this is going to make an absolutely incredible 30 for 30.
Oh, yeah. The documentary opportunities are gold here. And I think that what you would get in the sound bites would be guys on the sideline, and you would just hear him being like, man, this is not good. Like,
yeah,
this is, we're going to be five games in, and what's Deshaun going to do? Like, is he going to play? Like, you're not, and everything from Deshaun's going to be like, well, I mean, I'm here, aren't I? That's what I'm doing. That's it. You're not going to get anything out. The coaches are going to be like, well, we're working towards it, okay? We're working towards a goal here. Oh, boring. But the Deshaun Watson now says that he is not interested in playing for the New York Jets, which is what I said all along.
Yeah,
I said that didn't make sense at all. There was no reason for him to be interested in playing for the Jets. The only draw, maybe, other than, you know, living in New York and all this, would be the fact that they got a brand-new head coach, and Robert Saleh, I think the potential is really good. But that's it. It's not enough to want to draw a top-five quarterback over into a franchise that can't do anything. I mean, just because they got Robert Saleh, I expect the mindset to change. I expect the culture to change. But I don't expect the talent level to immediately change. Like, that's going to take some time, right? Doesn't matter who they get a quarterback. I saw today another draft where it looks like a mock draft where one of the guys for, I think it was McShay for ESPN, had the Jets getting Zach Wilson instead. And there, he actually had Justin Fields like the fifth quarterback taken in the draft, which I don't know. I think that's crazy. I'm not sure if the Jets would pass up on Justin Fields, but it's still. And Deshaun Watson doesn't want to go over there and embrace any of that and inherit any of that. But then again, I thought, you know, when we were discussing it this past Friday, it's like, yeah, you know, he says maybe he wants to go. It doesn't make sense. But he also is the same guy that signed an extension with the Texans, which I thought was a bad idea. So who knows? Maybe he actually does think there's interest in going there. But we find out now that he's apparently interested. There's a report coming out today in just two teams right now. That is the Miami Dolphins and the San Francisco 49ers, who currently for the Dolphins you have Tua, and then for the Niners you have Jimmy Garoppolo. So with those two teams being out there coming into next year, obviously both in the market for a quarterback, if he were to choose between those two teams, Zach, if you were Deshaun Watson, what makes the most sense for you, Dolphins or Niners?
Probably, I think Miami, honestly. You look at how good that defense was last year. The offense at times was pretty solid. The one thing that they missed was just consistent quarterback play.
Mm-hmm.
You know, they had it at times. Tua had a couple of sparks every now and then. But you didn't have a consistent, solid starting quarterback that was a difference maker. You know, it's similar weather to Houston, so it's not like it'd be a drastic change for him. He looks like a guy that would like to set out on the beach with a mimosa. You know, so I think that Miami is just it's a better situation than San Francisco, right? So I at least in my mind, I would think that he would rather go to Miami.
I'm going to say that I would actually, if I'm Deshaun Watson, I think the most sense makes the Niners here. And I say that because you look at what they pose when they're healthy. Defense is elite, right? And an elite defense, as we know, can really help a quarterback, especially lighten the load, you know, where he doesn't have to do it all like he's been doing in Houston. And so that's one thing. The other part of it is this: he has plenty of targets. Part of the reason, when you look at what Houston struggles with right now, there's nobody to throw to. I mean, everyone, for some reason, when I see people talk about Houston, they're like, well, they made the playoffs and all this recently, and yeah, they have, but, and then they're like, well, why does he want to leave? They have potential over there, but they don't have anybody. They don't have to throw to. Will Fuller is good for five games a year when he stays healthy, and DeAndre Hopkins has been gone for a season now. There's nobody else. So of course, Deshaun Watson, for that reason, would want to get out. But that's why it didn't make sense for me that he signed the extension, because there was no hope at that time of them getting any more weapons back. So he goes to the Niners, and he's got a number of young guys that he can get the ball to, not to mention a top three, top two tight end, George Kittle, when he's healthy. I mean, there's just an endless amount of opportunity there offensively. And if you think about what the Niners could offer, multiple picks, and they were to switch Jimmy G straight over. You know, you throw Jimmy G over to Houston, let him suffer with that team. And I'll tell you this, when Jimmy G goes over to the Texans, then we can just watch the Texans disappear, right? They're not relevant anymore with him being quarterback and nobody to throw to.
You don't think he's the next Tom Brady?
I do not. I do not think he's the next Tom Brady. I'm with you. He's more of a mimosa on the beach guy. That's a perfect way to put it. He really he has that look about him. And he has that. He doesn't do anything that's elite at quarterback. And you know what? Neither has Tua yet. You look at the Dolphins, and yeah, I'm with you. There were a couple times last season where I was like, oh, that looked pretty good. That looked pretty promising. But the rest of the time, it was like, seriously?
Yeah.
You guys benched Ryan Fitzpatrick for this guy? And they put Ryan Fitzpatrick back in, and he made a bigger difference than Tua ever did. And I know it was a limited amount of time, and I get that. You want to see a player develop, and there's going to be chances for it. But when Miami is already in the market for another quarterback after whiffing so far on Tua, that's not a great sign. So Jimmy G moving over and him going to the Niners would make the most sense. But again, I got to stop looking at it like Deshaun Watson feels like he knows what's best for him, right? Because if he did, he wouldn't have re-signed with the Texans, plain and simple.
I will say, though, kudos to him for figuring out that going to the Jets would be a terrible situation.
I wonder what took so long to figure that one out.
Not only is it just it would be a bad situation, but it's like what we talked about on Friday, right? So the Texans just don't want to trade him. So in order to trade him, they're like, all right, well, we're going to want two first-round picks and this much cash and this and that and a young defensive star, whatever. So let's say the Jets, they're like, you know what? That's doable. we can do that. Let's ship two first round picks. Let's ship a defensive player. Let's give them this. Let's give them that. We got everything they want, and we get Deshaun Watson. Then what? You ain't got first round picks to try to rebuild anything. You don't have offensive weapons. You don't have a young budding defensive star that is going to make a difference on the other side of the ball to help, you know, get the defense off the field and the ball back in Deshaun Watson's hand. So then what? Deshaun Watson's there for 2-3 years waiting on them to try to do anything, and all of a sudden we're back in the same situation.
Yeah, exactly.
He's, good budding head coach or not.
Right, and there's only so much he can do. You're going to be going over to another rebuild situation. If you go to the Niners, you know, you've got Debo Samuel, Brandon Ayuk, who both showed a lot of promise. I mean, this team was in a Super Bowl 2 years ago, and a lot of it was their defense, I know. But like I said, when they're healthy, and if you add Deshaun Watson replacing Jimmy Garoppolo in that offense, yeah, especially in that division where they have to be competitive right now or they just die. I mean, it's something that I think would make a ton of sense, and I get why Deshaun would want interest in that team, much more so than the Dolphins. I think there is chances there to make some moves, but look at that division. The Bills are going to run things for a while, man. I mean, let's be completely honest. They're going to run things for a while. In the NFC West, you're going to have, honestly, a pretty balanced out competition, really competitive division over there, but not so much for the AFC over there with Miami. And you've got a couple of weapons. I mean, Miles Gaskin's a good young running back. Gesicki's a decent tight end, and Devontae Parker shows up at times, and Preston Wilson when he's healthy. That's about it. I'm sorry, but if I'm choosing, I'm going to take the Niners, and I think he has a better chance there. But who knows, Zach? The way that Deshaun Watson reports have been coming out, you know, by Wednesday, we could be talking about how he says, "Now the Jets kind of have my interest again."
Yeah, you know, I wouldn't be surprised, you know, and the good thing is, though, if Deshaun Watson, you know, well, the problem is, yeah, you're right, you know, he signed probably an inadvisable recontract negotiation with Houston, you know, and that may or may not have been on, you know, falsified agreements. Mm-hmm. Oh, yeah, you know, we'll let you help us do this. We'll bring in a couple of players to try to help you on the offensive side, give you a good, you know, good offensive lineman, maybe another receiver or two. So that may have just been a young mistake. But the problem is Deshaun Watson is very, very quiet about everything. So all you have is just like what you and I have been doing, just a bunch of speculation. Well, is he going to go to New York? Well, it would make sense, but it doesn't make sense, and now he doesn't want to. You know, and now he's saying that he doesn't want to go to there. He doesn't want to go to that organization. He has his eyes on these two organizations. The good thing is there are multiple situations, multiple organizations that need a good quarterback, and there's precedent now where you can get, you know, two or three extra teams and do a four-way trade and get cash here and a pick there and send this guy there and get someone from them. And so I don't think this is going away anytime soon. I think the Deshaun Watson Houston saga is going to be around for at least another couple of months. But I honestly wouldn't be surprised either way. I wouldn't be surprised if he ended up in New York. I wouldn't be surprised if he stayed in Houston. I wouldn't be surprised if he went east or if he went west to San Francisco and Miami. I wouldn't be surprised if he ended up in some random team that didn't have anything to do with the conversation. Go north about 6 hours and land in Dallas. I could see that. I could see him, you know, winding up going to Pittsburgh. You know what I'm saying? I could see Mike Tomlin and his guys figuring out a way to land Deshaun Watson.
So and J.J. Watt, wow.
And J.J. Watt. Well, I tell you what, a team. Now, if they landed Deshaun Watson, I don't care if they landed J.J. Watt or not. If Pittsburgh landed Deshaun Watson, that's a difficult team, and they might not lose to Cleveland.
Yeah, that would be a really scary team. But you know,
absolutely.
I've narrowed it down though to squads.
Yeah, you don't have to worry about it anymore.
Yeah, yeah, exactly.
It'd be fun, but you don't have to worry.
Yeah, and it's just narrowed down to squads that have multiple picks and all this, and you know, the ball's still in the Texans' court at the moment.
Yeah,
but absolutely, they have a difficult decision to make here ultimately, and they are running out of time. Deshaun, I mean, it goes back to when he signed that extension. Had DeAndre Hopkins still been there, I wouldn't have faulted him for a second, right? Because you're able to build around a top five receiver and a top five quarterback. That's pretty easy to add pieces to, and you're going to find success. But with DeAndre Hopkins gone and Will Fuller automatically becomes your wide receiver one. You got nothing in return for DeAndre Hopkins to even improve your team. You got guys on the defensive side that are aging. Didn't really make a ton of sense to me there for Deshaun Watson, and obviously one he's regretting at this moment. When we come back here on the Afternoon Sports Drive, a crazy ending, the Daytona 500. I know Zach was glued to it, and we're going to talk about that to end this first hour. It was pretty wild. This is the Afternoon Sports Drive brought to you by Furniture Showcase, downtown at 5th and South Main here in Stillwater. They have a huge selection of mattresses right now at great prices, so make sure you go check them out. We're back with more after this. Afternoon Sports Drive on the Triple Play Sports Radio Network. Monday edition, Patrick Wheeler and Zach Lancaster rounding out this first hour. Show today brought to you by Furniture Showcase, downtown 5th and South Main. Stillwater's mattress store since 1982. From twin extra long singles up to California Kings, they've got everything you need. Your favorite mattress is going to be at Furniture Showcase. All right, Zach, so over the weekend, I'm not a huge racing guy, but I saw a couple of posts on Twitter like, oh, this finish is going to be wild, this finish is going to be crazy here in the Daytona 500, and I saw that there was a crash early in the race.
Yeah.
They had to kind of stop for a while with rain, quite a while, right? Like 5 hours, something like that.
So.
And the race didn't end until after midnight, but man, that was a wild ending, wasn't it?
Yeah, you know, last lap, Daytona, it's going to happen. Guarantee there's going to be a crash on the final lap of Daytona, probably at every single race. And what's crazy is this is the second year that we've had an insane finish, right? You go back to last year, and it was when Ryan Newman got flipped upside down and then T-boned.
Yeah.
It took them like 30, 35 minutes to, you know, extricate him from the car. And then he was unresponsive and he was in a medically induced coma for 2 days. Luckily that wasn't, you know, nothing like that happened. But it was a situation where, and I've seen it described a few different ways, because you go back, you know, 20 some odd years ago and drivers were really, really aggressive. But you took care of other drivers, you know. Nowadays, you look at drivers and they're really, really aggressive. Like Joey Logano was the reason. He's a 22 yellow Penske car in the Pennzoil. He's the reason that wreck happened. His teammate behind him, Brad Keselowski, had a hell of a run, pushed by the eventual winner, Michael McDowell. And so he goes to try to go around Logano, and Logano just throws one of the worst blocks I've ever seen, and they both just get taken out. And then Kyle Busch runs into the back of Keselowski, and then the fuel tank explodes, and there's two or three cars. Bubba Wallace was wrapped up in that. Austin Cindric, a rookie. So it was, of all the finishes, I don't know if it was the craziest finish, but you don't see too many wrecks where fuel tanks explode and you see lots of carnage like that, because that was pretty crazy. But the fact that it was two teammates that it happened to, you know, Logano, and that there's been multiple situations where Logano just I'm gonna just jump in front of this guy, he's certainly not gonna rear end me. Well, they're highly ill-advised and just really, really stupid. But I enjoy good wreck, you know. I enjoy good wreck at Daytona. I wasn't too happy with the one that happened earlier in the race, less than 20 laps into that race. That was really stupid. And then before they even get restarted on that, they throw the red flag, and then, you know, what, like you said, it was like 4.5-5 hours where there was nothing going on, just setting and setting and setting and setting, and they thought about putting it off till today. I'm glad they didn't. But it's this year, I think, is going to be one of the crazier years we've seen in a while. I think they, you know, like football and like college basketball, they figured out a way to do this safely. I think you're going to see more and more fans in the stands as well, so that'll add an extra element of excitement to it. But I think you're going to see a lot of emotions this year. If you're a NASCAR fan, even if you're not a NASCAR fan, you know, if you just, you know, you're looking for something exciting to do on the weekends, I think this season poses a lot of fun.
Yeah, and props to NASCAR and racing, you know, for getting back as early as they did. They really had a concerned effort into getting back and doing so safely and doing so in a fun manner. So it was a really good job by them to kind of lead the way back into sports returning. And of course, a crazy finish last night in the Daytona 500, mm-hmm. which, as we mentioned last week, is kind of the sign that we're getting into some of these bigger events. The Masters are right around the corner. March Madness is right around the corner. Spring training right around the corner, yeah. Right? In baseball, it's going to be a lot of fun to get everything kind of ramped back up and hopefully get back a little bit to normal in the sports world.
Did you see the Kansas City Royals? Did you see the tweet they sent out about 20 minutes ago?
I did not.
So their spring training is in Surprise, Arizona.
Yep.
Kansas City, 23 minutes ago, was -4 and snowing, and Surprise is 64 and sunny.
Yeah, they just did it's kind of the same thing, just different teams here. They just did I'm watching the Blues and the Coyotes here on the TV. Mm-hmm. They have a random 3 o'clock hockey game today, and they're in Phoenix, and they showed the overview of the drone shot, and it's just sunny, and there's not a snowflake to be found. And
that's wrong. They need to do, if there's ever any temperature that's below 10 degrees, you have outdoor hockey.
Wow.
Wrap them up. You're telling me you can't build a hockey rink in downtown Stillwater?
I like the idea. Outdoor hockey's cool. You've seen some of those games they played in baseball stadiums and stuff.
I love their stadiums.
It's awesome.
The Winter Classic is one of the greatest spectacles in all of sports.
It really is.
Not just hockey. Any sport ever created, outdoor hockey is where it's at.
I completely agree, man. It is a lot of fun to watch. I think they're going to try to do some of that again this year like normal, so I'll have to keep an eye on that. But yeah, I'm with you. You know, why not? Let's get a frozen rink going on here in Stillwater, have ourselves a hockey game. I mean, it'll be great.
Tear down the tree, tear down that, you know, rip up that little island in the middle of Theta Pond. Bring the Bruins and the Toronto Maple Leafs and just have a little hockey here on campus.
There you go. I think we're on to something there. Let's give us the city managers and we'll get back.
Yeah, we can make this happen.
This is the Afternoon Sports Drive. You never know what you're going to get here on this show. Great ideas, great topics all the time. Show today brought to you by Furniture Showcase here in Stillwater, downtown 5th and South Main. When we come back, hour number two, we'll get into some buy or sell. And one former college football legend, and in his brief time in the NFL, made quite a name for himself too, is back in the sport of football. We'll talk about him coming up in hour number two as well. This is the Afternoon Sports Drive. And I don't know. Welcome back in Afternoon Sports Drive, Triple Play Sports Radio Network, hour number two. Patrick Wheeler and Zach Lancaster live, Triple Play Sports Radio Studios here in downtown Stillwater. Brought to you today by Furniture Showcase, downtown 5th and South Main here in Stillwater. Make sure and check them out at stillwaterfurnituresshowcase.com. Big names in your favorite mattress brands. Just got a text earlier from our very own Tom Dorado. Tommy D let me know, since we were talking about NASCAR, that his brother Chris Dorado, who was big into NASCAR, right, and had a lot of ties there, will be on Where Are They Now Wednesday. So he'll have plenty more on the Daytona 500, and he'll have lots on spring training going on there in his state as well. So be sure to stick around for that. Of course, you can hear Tommy D's Where Are They Now every Wednesday at 5 p.m. right after our show. So should be some good stuff there. Here to start off this second hour, we're going to get into a little bit of buy or sell.
Are you buying?
I'd buy that for a dollar.
Or are you selling?
You'll pick up the phone and you'll sell, sell, sell.
This is Buy or Sell on the Afternoon Sports Drive.
Make money, money, make money.
Buy or Sell, Afternoon Sports Drive, Triple Play Sports Radio, Patrick Wheeler and Zach Lancaster. All right, Zach, so we did hit on this a little bit in the first hour, so it might be a quick one, but buy or sell, because we saw no ice against Kansas State as sort of expected, at least by us. So buy or sell that he sees any time at all against Iowa State tomorrow.
Yeah, that's a good one, you know, because it's really peculiar, if you will, because before, you know, you really dig into Iowa State, you know, and let me, I've got this, I wrote an article on it this morning during my preview for the game tomorrow. Iowa State, so you've got four starters averaging in double digits. Rasir Bolton, Jalen Coleman-Lance, Solomon Young, and Javon Johnson. It's 16 points. You're looking at 13 points, 11.5, and 10.5 points. You look at Rasir Bolton. He's averaging 17.3 points in the last four games. That's OU, two against Kansas and one against TCU. Jalen Coleman-Lance, 20 points in back-to-back games against Kansas. And then freshman Jaden Walker, 14 rebounds against Kansas. That's the most from any Iowa State freshman since 96-97. So while they've lost 10 straight, Iowa State is certainly playing like one of the better teams in the conference. I'll sell the fact that Isaac likely starts against Iowa State, but I think he plays. I don't know how much he plays, and I'm not saying that he has to play because Rondell Walker, you know, won't be able to get the job done in his place. But I think Ice just gives you that stoppability. You know, we don't know what his foot is. You know, the severity of that. We knew that. You know, Boynton said that it's been bugging him for about a month and a half. It wasn't going to get any worse, but it certainly wasn't going to get any better unless he rested. And you know, everyone kind of thought that these two games were it. And there's no question that week off plus Kansas State and probably yesterday, you know, staying off that foot was huge. So I would think that Ice plays some against Iowa State. To what extent, I don't think we'll see him playing 30-plus, you know, but I could see him playing half the game in spurts because he gives you that stopping ability. You know, throw him out there for a charge, he can get a block, you know, he can get a steal, create a fast break. So he gives you a lot. I think Oklahoma State can win by 10, but I think you're going to need Ice to help get it done.
Yeah, see, I think I'm going to sell it. I don't think he plays at all against Iowa State because a foot issue, and however minor or major it is, we know for a basketball player, that's there's no such thing as too much rest for a foot issue.
No, for sure.
And this is an Iowa State team that, yes, I completely agree. You know, they're not the same team, literally, by any means, that Oklahoma State faced earlier on in the year. Now, that was in part to they had plenty of COVID issues going on and could barely put a team out there on the court. But with the players they have now, yes, they've improved a little bit, but they're still struggling. You know, to be completely honest, as we know, as you mentioned there, and they're an Oklahoma State squad that should easily take care of it, like they were taking care of Kansas State in that first half. I think OSU can get away with sitting Ice again, because you think about this stretch coming up, they need him full go. I mean, they don't need to be, you know, going into Baylor, Texas Tech, possibly West Virginia, Oklahoma twice. You don't need to be going into those games with Ice, who's limited or can only give you so many minutes or this or that or whatever. If you can get through an Iowa State game And even without him, if you're at the end of that game and it's a really close game, like you said in that first half, then we got some more problems we're going to have to address because this OSU team is deep enough and Rondell's filled in nice so far. And I know you're right that Ice, when he is out there, there's a lot of things that he does that other players don't do. So is he being missed these first couple games that he's out? Yeah, absolutely. He's a guy that you want out there from a leadership standpoint too. But it's not just the end of this season. It's like I mentioned earlier, tournament play coming up, Big 12 tournament play, in the March Madness tournament, possibly in the NCAA tournament there. You know, you've got all this to look forward to, and we all saw what happened last year when Ice was out for an extended period of time. I know Cade wasn't there, but it wasn't the same team. And so for an extended period of time, I don't think it'd be the same team either this year. So they need him back. And I think that means they're going to rest him for another game. As much as I'd love to see him play against Iowa State, because I think he would have a solid game against them, I'm going to sell. What you got?
Yeah, so I'm going to stick with basketball, and it's something that I wrote in the text to you in parentheses. I'm going to have to use this until they prove me wrong. You go back to the Iowa State game in January, and Oklahoma State had a season-high 24 turnovers. Now, granted, just like against Kansas State, they forced, I think, 21 or 22 against Iowa State in January. So while they're turning the ball over a lot, they're also creating a lot of havoc on the defensive end. So, and now they're still, turnovers are still obviously an issue for Oklahoma State, but it appears that the numbers are going down, dwindling a little bit, and I don't know if we're going to see another 20-pluser. But buy or sell, we see 15 or less turnovers from Oklahoma State against Iowa State.
I guess I would buy it because my prediction is it's going to be right at that 15 mark. Mm-hmm. So I would say, you know, 15 is kind of where they've been hovering around here. They seem to be good for 15 turnovers a game. Now, this is an Iowa State team that shouldn't happen against by any means. But, again, the reason Oklahoma State has so many is because sometimes they're completely out of control. They try to get the ball in too quick, or they take bad angles, you know. And it's something that lazy passes, really. And that's if I have anything that's just, you know, concerning to me from this team right now, it's those things right there that I would have thought would have already been taken care of by this point. You know, that's the most concerning part. I don't know if they're just not buying into let's fix it, or if they get into in-game situations and it's just not the same, and or whatever. You can use whatever excuse you want. But to me, it's something that has to be fixed. Now, if they go in against an Iowa State squad and you know, stay under double-digit turnovers, and then we're talking about a really good game where they're valuing every single possession. I also think, Zach, it's easy against Kansas State and Iowa State, for instance, teams like this, where you necessarily don't value every possession because you think in the back of your head multiple reasons why. One, we're such a talented team. Who cares if we turn it over? Either we're going to get it back and get a stop, or we'll just outscore them here in a minute. But the other reason is kind of that, too. Late in the game, it's like, yeah, well, we're going to have possessions later on, and we're going to score, we know, against this defense. So who cares? We turn it over, blah, 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 here and there, whatever. But it can't be like that. You know, you got to value every single possession in every game. It doesn't matter the opponent, because it's going to come down. One of these games here is going to come down to the very last possession. And you're going to be thinking to yourself, man, if we hadn't turned it over 15, 16, 17 times, how ahead would we be? Because a lot of it's happened, too, with leads, right? That's the thing. They're coming out to leads in these games, and that you would think there that you would still be really careful with the basketball, but they get lackadaisical at times. And I'm not going to blame it on them being young. These are a bunch of players that understand how to play basketball. They understand how to move the basketball. Sometimes they get too pretty with passes. I get it. It does happen. But, man, not that many times in a game and not at this point in the season. I can't say it enough. If you want to go far, if you want to make any sort of run, because let's be honest, Zach, look at everybody else in the Big 12. Yes, it's super competitive, but if Oklahoma State got the right run, would anybody be extremely surprised to see them make a run in the Big 12 tournament? I mean, really, if they lined up good and their offense is good and everybody's healthy, there's no reason to think they couldn't compete with most of these teams, maybe besides Baylor. And even then, they probably could compete with them. I don't think they could win, but they could compete. So these are things that they have to fix. Turnovers, absolutely. And until, I think I've said this the past 2 or 3 weeks, until they can prove me wrong with the 15, you know, or under that, then I'm gonna be selling.
Yeah. So, you know, I think you're I think you're pretty spot on. You know, I think you've got to be able to clean him up, but I think you look at Boynton and hit, you know, you go back to that game on Saturday and you look at Boynton and you look at the staff, anytime someone turned the ball over and it wasn't, you know, it wasn't a forced turnover, then almost immediately thereafter, there was someone up off the bench going to the scorer's table to replace him. You know, and then we found out on Friday that the past couple days that they had only, you know, like, well, so we have 14 players, we're going to have 14 balls out there, and if, you know, if they turn the ball over, we're going to take one of the balls away, and as soon as we're out of basketballs, we're just going to run, and each time we turn the ball over, we're going to run. So you could see the dejection in the game after each turnover on Saturday. So I'll buy that they have 15 or less. And honestly, I don't know how much better it's going to get, but you can tell that they're really starting to care, because anytime you see a turnover, you just, you know, look up the upper right-hand corner of your screen and look at Boynton's reaction and the other coach's reaction of a turnover, because they're bad turnovers. I don't care, you know, youth is not a factor with these turnovers, because these guys have been playing in high-level AAU ball. They play high-level high school basketball. We're, what, 19 games into this season almost, you know, something like that, almost 20 games into this season. I don't buy youth. I don't buy that's the case of these turnovers. Something's got to be done. And I think we're seeing that. You know, it's the turnovers that we are seeing aren't, you know, the past few games have been pretty bad, but they're certainly less than they were earlier in the year. I don't know how much less than 15 they're going to have against Iowa State. I would love, with, like you said, I would love to have, you know, single digit turnovers. I don't think it's going to happen. I think you're going to see up to 15, but I don't think certainly more than 15. And I would love to be wrong on 15.
Yeah, and I'm not saying, hey, oh, we have to have a game where you turn it over three times. You know, I don't expect anything like that. But this number was super disappointing, because it's a Kansas State team that they're not that great on defense. They just aren't. You know, a lot of them were just Oklahoma State killing themselves. And that's where, you know, we don't want that to be the story at the end of the season. That's what I'm saying. You don't want to have to come back to the end of this year and look wherever Oklahoma State finishes and go, man, if they could have just tightened up the, you know, the protecting the basketball, where would they be? Who knows? But I don't want it to be that way. So certainly it's something that in a short amount of time has to be fixed. And I have confidence that it will improve at some point here before the regular season ends. So buy or sell that coming up tomorrow, mentioned Ice. And if he doesn't play, Rondell will most likely get the start again. So let's say he does start, just for the purpose of this conversation here. Buy or sell that he finishes in double digits again if he gets another start?
Yeah, I think there's a pretty good chance that he starts. Boynton said on Saturday after the game that Ice will be basically a game time decision. I think it'll be kind of like on Saturday. We'll see whether or not he's warming up in pregames. And, you know, if he is, I think we'll see him play. If not, then I think that's pretty indicative of how that game's going to go. That's his first start for Rondell Walker on Saturday. He had to get 10 against Kansas State. I think Iowa State's a much trickier defensive team than Kansas State was. I think Iowa State's going to give Oklahoma State more problems than they had against Kansas State. But you look at him. He had 20 points last time against Iowa State, and I know that was a different Iowa State team than what they're playing right now. But I think Rondell will have enough, especially with it being at home. I think Rondell will have enough. I think he'll create a lot. You know, I think he'll have 3+ assists. I think he'll probably have 2+ steals, 4+ rebounds. And I think that'll be enough to help get him over the hump. I'll buy double digits. I'm not saying that he's going to have another 20-pointer. But I think 10 is very doable for Rondell.
Yeah, I'm going to buy it, too. I could see him in that 10-15 range. And if he gets looks like he did against Kansas State, which there was a number of them early in that game, too, where he traditionally knocks those shots down, I could see him for sure passing that 10-point number. And it's an Iowa State team that, yeah, it's going to be a little different defensively, but he's going to get his chances. And it's not – I'm not going to, you know, relegate him to a three-point specialist by any means, because we know he can get points in other ways. He just loves that shot in the corner. He can get points a lot of different ways. So I think he's going to have that ability, especially if Ice doesn't play or even if he's in a limited amount. It's going to give Rondell plenty of chances for extra touches. And I'll tell you this, you know, he keeps coming out with the energy that he provides. He's going to earn himself more time no matter what. I mean, this dude is he's having a really good start to his career at Oklahoma State, doing a lot of things that many players avoid. And that's diving for loose balls. That's going after passes and picking them off. That's being a factor defensively, even though he's undersized at times. It doesn't matter. He's really done a good job with what time he's been given this season. So, yeah, I'm going to buy. I think he has a really nice game against Iowa State coming up here. What else you got?
Sticking with a freshman, going down low, M.A. Didn't have the best of games against Kansas State. But you go back to that earlier Iowa State game, he had a career high 22-12. Now this, as we keep mentioning, this is a different Iowa State team. They're going to have Solomon Young back, who did not play against Oklahoma State back in January. He's averaging 11.3 points a game, close to 5 rebounds a game. So buy or sell, MA has a similar performance against Iowa State on Tuesday like he did back in January?
Well, if you look back at that game, he was able to really do whatever he wanted around the basket. That was, you know, tipping in half the time. If he was missing a shot, he was tipping it back in. There was no resistance for him down low, especially on second chance points. So he came away with a lot of those and kind of dominated around the rim. And he played 35 minutes. Not 35 minutes. I was looking at the TCU game. Against Iowa State, 11 field goals on 17 attempts. So he took 17 shots. I mean, like, again, he had all those opportunities with a really good chance to convert on a lot of them. So I'm not sure he'll get that many again. I don't think he'll score over 20. But I do think he has a solid game, 15, 17, somewhere in there, if he does play more. You know, if he's not as limited here and he comes back in with a full slate, full opportunity to play in this game. And it's going to go between him and Caleb, you know, because I want to see, is Caleb going to be able to kind of bounce back and get back to where he was a few games ago? Is this a chance for him against Iowa State to make some noise, not just rebounding, but scoring the basketball? Which one of these guys is going to step up? So he'll have a good game. I think he's too athletic and at times too dominant when he gets the ball in his hands to not have a good game against this Iowa State team, which still lacks on the defensive side.
Yeah, I think he has the chance to have a similar game. Now, I don't think he's going to crack 20. You know, I think that's going to be a bit of a stretch, 22-12. But I think he can get close. You know, I think he can score, you know, 12-15. But now Solomon Young's going to be a handful. You know, Solomon Young is one of the more talented big men in the country, in the conference. I think he's going to give Oklahoma State a lot of problems down low, but I think you're spot on with Caleb. I think you're going to have to get a big performance from Caleb. You know, you can't go out there and have him play, you know, 14 minutes and score 6 points. You're going to need Caleb to play a bulk of the game. You're going to need him to figure it out and pull in rebounds and hit tough shots. And if he does that, then I'll sell on MA, because MA, you know, we don't exactly know where he's at health wise. I think he played 16 minutes against Kansas State. That's up from the 9 against Kansas. But if Caleb has a poor performance, if he goes out there and just kind of struggles and, you know, can't hit shots and he rides the bench a lot, then I think that opens up the door for MA, and I think you'll see him rise to that test. But I'll sell it just because I don't think he's going to get close enough in points to really officially deem it a similar game.
So over the weekend, we saw one former college football legend. Mm-hmm. Now, some people may have different opinions about whether it was a good type of legendary status or a bad type of whatever you want to say there. But Johnny Manziel was back in football action. this weekend in the fan-created league. And if you remember right, I think this was kind of what I learned at one point. I think I mentioned this back when we heard about it. But it's a four-game season in Atlanta that these teams play. And it's like a mix of the AAF and a mix of the XFL all packed into one with a bunch of different twists. And I like it's fun. It's kind of fun, right, overall. It's a short field. It's a little more compacted, so there's big play opportunity. But it's something that you would probably be like, okay, I'm good for it being four games, you know, type of thing. Mm-hmm. You wouldn't sit there and just like watch a ton of this. But it was really interesting for the short segments I watched, only available on Twitch, which in case anyone doesn't know what that is, it's an app and can be found online where people stream themselves playing video games and videos and stuff like this. So it was only available that way. Saw a bunch of it on Twitter. Buy or sell that Johnny Manziel ever makes it back in the NFL?
So I need you to read me the quote on air that you read me during the timeout.
Okay, I was going to save this, Zach, but okay, I'm going to bring it up now that you mentioned it. All right, Johnny Manziel, after the game, had his little presser, right, because they had to talk to him. He's obviously the most famous name in this little league. He said, quote, because, by the way, a little pretense, his team name is the Zappers. So his quote was, "Win or lose, we booze on the Zappers," end quote.
I'm pretty sure that quote right there tells you all you need to know about whether Johnny Manziel is going to be back in the NFL. Read an article, I'm selling, by the way, if you couldn't tell by that opening remark. I read an article before you read me this question, and the opening line of the article is, "Johnny Manziel is still doing Johnny Manziel things." Nearly scored a touchdown on his opening drive.
That's a Johnny Manziel thing right there, nearly scoring a touchdown.
Johnny Manziel's first FCF snap almost goes for six. Okay, well,
almost.
For starters, it's like a 40-yard field, right?
Yes.
It's like maybe 15 yards across. This thing looks smaller than an arena league mm-hmm. field. It wouldn't be hard for Johnny Manziel to go, you know, 30, 35 yards. And who the hell is he playing? You know, like, it's not like he's going up against, you know, Von Miller and J.J. Watt and you slap a couple of the best safeties in the league back there and... Yeah, no, he's playing against a bunch of guys that played semi-pro football, and they're hanging on to a dream because they think they're going to make it back. It's embarrassing, to be honest with you. And there's no way on God's green earth that Johnny Manziel makes it back to the NFL, unless it's like Waterboy or something.
Yeah, it's like 7-on-7, basically arena-type football. The fans get to control things like team names, logos. They can even call the plays. So there's a lot of involvement for them there. He went 1 of 5 passing for 11 yards. But the scramble he had there that you mentioned had a bunch of views and stuff, and that kind of got the attention. I sent you the clip. They had Marshawn Lynch in the booth with some commentary, and he could, you know, say whatever he wants. So he's kind of cursing and up a storm and everything, and it's pretty hilarious. And to me, by the way, Zach, that's my $1 billion idea. Okay, you. Every Marshawn single Lynch. Time for games, not just Marshawn Lynch. Oh, you okay. You get an alternate broadcast on, you know, FX or some other channel, and it's basically like a Barstool type commentary with guys like Marshawn Lynch and everyone else that can curse and say whatever they want during the game, so people can watch that if they want. $1 billion idea. So keep that in the back pocket. But no, I'm sorry, Johnny won't be back. As
he's
I mentioned,
going to be the Jets' next quarterback.
Yeah, right. Even the Jets might not want him. I mean, it's funny because I mentioned the quote there. But it's like you said, to me, it's also a little sad because we know that was part of the reason he couldn't stay in the NFL, right? He had issues, and I think he went to Alcoholics Anonymous once or twice. Nothing ever worked, and he could never get out of his own way. You know, he never matured enough to actually stay on a team long enough to make any sort of an impact, which I know a lot of people were skeptical about when he came in the league anyways, and it just didn't work out. So it's hilarious, but it's also a little sad because it's like, man, that's where he belongs, you know? It's like you can kind of tell he still has a little bit of athletic ability. It's like, remember when he used to do this and run like that at times and Texas A&M and blah, 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 it was all good. But now look at him, man. It's like, that's great for him, I guess, if he's enjoying it.
Johnny Manziel is going to be the 50-year-old guy going back to high school games in his hometown, you know, wearing his letter jacket and his
saying that he made it.
Ring.
He's like, guys, I made it. By the way, I just, you know, I was a legend for like three
remember
games.
That time I was drafted by the Cleveland Browns. Yeah, he's gonna be that kind of pathetic hometown guy that wears his letter jacket. You know it's embarrassing.
Yeah, you know, like, the type.
I wish him well. Like, I wish him well health wise. You know, I hope he's able to. I hope he has his problems in order. You know, I don't wish ill will on him. But I mean, you're playing for a joke of a semi-pro fan-ran football league on Twitch. You know, trying to keep up those glory days. Just go back to College Station. You know, go to wherever you want to go. I mean, you'd be better off just, you know, playing with the high school boys on the weekend, you know, after the game's over, going out there with the middle schoolers and throwing the ball around while the varsity's in the locker room.
Yeah, and you know, the XFL was cool. I mean, it had some different insights into the game, and it wasn't like a complete sort of joking type thing like this is.
No, but it was good football. It was just ran poorly.
Yeah, it was just they had some issues there running it, but they had some good ideas. I thought a couple of things that were interesting here about the FCL. One, you had the point after attempt is one-on-one. So the quarterback is handed the football. You have a receiver against a defensive back, and you go one-on-one, score the extra point. That was pretty interesting. And then get this. You don't flip a coin to decide the kickoff, who gets the ball. You play rock, paper, scissors to decide the kickoff. Yeah, hilarious.
You throw dynamite in there?
Yeah, right? Anything you want.
Driver, hurricane.
Yeah. Anything goes. Anything goes. One guy, when he scored a touchdown, he celebrated by eating a Wendy's doubles classic over there, whatever you call it, in the end. I kid you not. He whipped out a Wendy's burger and was eating it after he celebrated a touchdown. So there's potential here for a lot of hilarious Twitter clips. But that's pretty much it. So it is kind of it's kind of a two-way street for Johnny Manziel. Hilarious, but also kind of sad if you think about where he was at one point with some of the potential to come in and play professional football. This is the Afternoon Sports Drive brought to you by the Furniture Showcase here in Stillwater. Check them out online at stillwaterfurnituresHowcase.com. When we come back, one lady over the weekend was not too happy with Tom Brady. Because he decided to basically yeet that Super Bowl trophy across one boat to the other, which went viral over social media. But this lady, does she have reason to be upset? We're going to talk about that coming up next. In Afternoon Sports Drive, Triple Play Sports Radio Network, Patrick Wheeler, Zach Lancaster, Monday edition, live from the Triple Play Sports Radio studios here in downtown Stillwater. Brought to you by Furniture Showcase, downtown 5th and South Main. Much easier and much better than driving to the big city. You don't have to go to Tulsa. You don't have to go to OKC. You can stay here in Stillwater and find all your furniture needs at Furniture Showcase. Check them out online at stillwaterfurnitureshowcase.com. So, Zach, last week we saw plenty of videos of Tom Brady kind of letting loose, enjoying the Super Bowl celebration with his teammates. Of course, he stumbles off the boat when he hit dry land, and I thought it was a pretty classic look because it was basically that you know, dad and his middle-aged dad type look, where, you know, you never really get to drink with the buddies anymore, and he hangs out, got a few drinks with the buddies, and is enjoying himself away from the family type thing. So that's what we saw from Tom Brady. And then, of course, the video where he's on his $2 million yacht, and he launches the Lombardi trophy over the next boat to Gronk and everybody else there who catch it and it lands safely. So, of course we would have this story to talk about in 2021, where Karen Lombardi is now her name, by the way. I mean, like, of course it is, right? So everyone knows what a Karen is these days. Karen Lombardi, she was upset. This lady was. She was the daughter of the man that made the Lombardi trophy. Basically, you know, the silversmith of it, had the design and everything. She came out over the weekend and said that she was very upset when she saw that video that Tom Brady threw that, disregarded the trophy, said that she couldn't sleep for 2 days. She was so upset about it. And then wants an apology from Tom Brady. And I don't know if you saw today, but the Bucks GM had a pretty hilarious response to it on Twitter. There was a post made about it, about the whole story and everything. Jason Licht is the GM, and his response were two words. You ready for this? Here was his response. Lighten up was his response. And I think it's just like, man, people are so tensed up and always finding something to be mad or offended about. And I'm just like, chill out. First of all, I did some research. That trophy would only cost $10,000 to get remade, by the way, if it were broken. Okay, so it's not like it was this once-in-a-lifetime thing. Now, the other part of it I thought, too, was interesting. Remember recently, back when the Patriots won Super Bowl, when Rob Gronkowski dented the Super Bowl trophy? And it became a story like he was using it as a baseball bat. Where was her outrage for that? She was mad at Tom Brady here. So I thought that was pretty hilarious. But also at the same time, it's like, man, we get mad at every single. You can't do anything anymore. You're going to upset somebody.
So on the surface, I think she had a right to be upset. Simply from the fact of, you know, her family did this, and it's a legacy, and this and that and this and that. So yeah, you could be upset. That's fair, right? But to come out and say that you couldn't sleep for 2 days and that you demand an apology, like, lighten up. You know, I mean, for real. If you think about it, like, sure, you know, you could be upset. You know, that's fair. You know, this was your dad's legacy. This is what he did. You know, and you really care about that. But you cannot tell me that she legitimately sat down and said, you know what, if I voice this frustration in a TV spot, in an interview, I think it will be accepted, and I have a good shot of getting an apology. No.
I think that was maybe part of her mindset was, I'm going to get a ton of people coming to my rescue for this. You know, everyone's going to call, oh, Tom Brady. We have plenty of people that don't like Tom Brady. Of course they'll get behind me here. They got to back this up, and he's going to be forced to apologize and all this. And I mean, I guess you can be upset about it, whatever. But, I mean, come on now. Who cares? He was just having some fun. It's not a big deal. It was caught safely. It's not like I don't think he doesn't just disregard the trophy. But it's like I said to you the other day. He's got seven of them now, right? It wasn't. Well, he's like, here you go. I've seen this before.
And even if it went into the water, you know, you're telling me that Gronk wouldn't jump in.
Hey, it would have been recovered
down to the bottom.
Yeah,
and get it.
It would have been recovered. Okay.
And Tom Brady, just Tom Brady alone, in the amount of time it took him to, you know, like child, you know, count 1, 2, 3, and then throw it. And then from the time he started counting, or even just before when he was like, all right, I'm going to throw it to you. You guys ready? From that time to the time it was caught, Tom Brady could have afforded to replace it. Like that like 12 seconds, if anything happened to it, Tom Brady could have been like, well, the amount of time it took me, I'll give you a blank check. Wow. And you're telling me you're telling me that in the middle of a global pandemic, in the middle of all of this stock market uncertainty, that Mrs. Lombardi, Karen Lombardi, wouldn't want her company or her family's company or whoever to have a, you know, an extra 10,000 bones? Get out of here.
Yeah. It's one of those things where I just, again, I feel like people are too upset about everything. You know, I get you have some personal ties, but was it worth the energy to be that upset about?
I knew it was fake. Like, you could tell that it's fake outrage. Simply, like, I didn't sleep for 2 days.
Come on.
For what?
Come on.
It's not like it's not even. I don't even think you could be upset for 2 days if Tom Brady tossed a kid. You know, because the boats would obviously be closer. You know, you want to toss a kid across and they're going to catch it. Okay, great. But if the kid goes in the water, guess what? Nothing. The kid gets wet.
Zach, let's just fold and not hand out trophies anymore. Like the Super Bowl, you just get named the champion. You don't get a trophy. You don't get to raise anything at the end there.
It's not like you had early 2000s era BCS football teams going out and playing catch with a crystal football.
Right. Well, and I saw a lot of people say if she thought that was bad, imagine what she would think if she had connections to the Stanley Cup, right?
Dude, every single player on the team gets a certain amount of time with the trophy and the handlers.
Yes.
There's I don't remember what team. I think it was the Bruins, I think, a few years ago. And I don't even remember who the player was. It was that long ago, and I haven't thought about it in a while. But the dude, I think he had it for like a week or something. He ate cereal out of it 3 times a day.
I know. The amount of people that have drank beer and whatever else out of that,
and all the kissing and sweating and blood and milk and champagne and blech.
Yeah,
that is probably the most revered trophy in all of sport ever.
Yeah, no, it absolutely is. She could be. Oh, she lost two days of sleep because that trophy was tossed. I wouldn't want to know what would happen if she was.
Players put octopus in the trophy. They put octopi in there and dead fish. But God forbid Tom Brady throw the Lombardi trophy 15 feet to, who did he throw it to? An NFL wide receiver.
Yeah, I mean, look, he's a 7-time Super Bowl champion. Okay, he can do what he wants. I mean, big deal. Get over it. It's nothing that I'm going to – I think should be – any sleep should be lost if it really was or not. We will maybe never know. Show today brought to you by Furniture Showcase here on the Afternoon Sports Drive. When we come back here to round out this first hour, we're going to tell you what we learned here to get you out of here on your Monday. It's coming up.
Feel like I'm gonna puke, cause my taxes are due. Do my password begin with a 1 or a 2? Been a hell of a ride, but I'm thinking it's time to grow.
Metronome.
Man, I'm up to something. Ooty-la-dee-do, thank you all for coming. I hope you like the show, cause it's on a budget. So ooty-la-dee-do, yeah, come on, here we go, yeah, come on.
Here we go.
So on, everybody pretend you know this song. Everybody come hang. Let's go out.
Welcome back in Afternoon Sports Drive, Triple Play Sports Radio Network. Patrick Wheeler, Zach Lancaster, as we get ready to round out the show here on this Monday. Show brought to you by Furniture Showcase, 5th and Main, here in downtown Stillwater. All your furniture and mattress needs, make sure you go check them out. Furniture, StillwaterFurnitureShowcase.com. To round out the show, we're going to give you a little bit of what we learned.
The day is coming to an end. Time to find out if these two got any smarter. Let's find out what the guys learned today on the Afternoon Sports Drive.
Well, well, I learned something today.
Well, Zach, not great news, as you alluded earlier to me today, former wide receiver in the NFL, Vincent Jackson, was found dead this morning in Florida, just 38 years old. Anyone that's a Chiefs fan surely remembers that name. When he played with the Chargers, he was good. His speed was really the defining factor of what he always was able to do as a receiver. Finished the last few seasons in Tampa Bay. Last time he played was in 2016, five seasons there. And he's fourth all-time in that Tampa Bay history, 4,326 receiving yards, and he's 10th in receptions. And with the Chargers, who picked him in the 2005 draft, he's tied for 8th with touchdowns, 37, and 10th receiving yards, over 4,754. That's 544 catches, 540 catches for 9,080 yards and 57 touchdowns. So that's a pretty productive 12-season career there for Vincent Jackson, and he always put on a show when he got the ball in his hands. I remember him well. So that's definitely sad news. They don't have any reason for death yet. No cause of death. He was found alone in the hotel over there. His family had reported him missing. So I'm not going to speculate, but that's never good news. So of course we'll be awaiting to see what happened with him there. But Vincent Jackson, man, he was a fun receiver to watch. Really talented, awesome speed, and I know he's going to be missed. He had a ton to do with helping military families, and he helped police officers out a lot with the foundations that he had. So he was a really good guy. You know, gave back to the community a lot there. So that's tough to hear.
Yeah, I read that as of right now, there were no signs of trauma mm-hmm. when they found him, so they're not sure what's going on. But prayers to his family. That's really tough. So a little more upbeat. Oklahoma State running back commit Ollie Gordon, really really talented running back out of the Dallas Fort Worth area there at Euless Trinity High School. The Dallas Morning News, they've got a section called Sports Day High School. It's the number one, they claim it's the number one source for Dallas area high school sports. But they have ranked Ollie Gordon the number one running back in the Dallas-Fort Worth area, and he is actually the number 13 overall prospect out of the Dallas-Fort Worth area. And anyone covers college football or watches college football at all, it doesn't even matter if you're an Oklahoma team or a Texas team or Arkansas or whatever. Everyone in the country knows that some of the best high school athletes in the country come from Texas and that Dallas-Fort Worth area. So Oklahoma State getting a good one. Again, Ollie Gordon, they have him the 13th overall prospect out of the Dallas area and the number one running back out of the Dallas area.
Running back you maybe over here.
I tell you what,
because we ended up, you enjoyed Chuba. And then, of course, Dez Jackson showed out this year with the chances he got. Got Ollie coming in. Man, that's going to be a deep running back room.
Yeah, don't forget Dominic Richardson.
He played well. Man, you got a lot of – that's going to be a deep running back room this season, man. I can't wait for the future in that position for OSU. Should be a lot of fun. This has been the Afternoon Sports Drive here on the Triple Play Sports Radio Network show today, brought to you by Furniture Showcase, downtown 5th and South Main. Again, you can check them out at StillwaterFurnitureShowcase.com. All the best mattresses and furniture that you're going to find. Appreciate them as always. That's Zach Lancaster. I'm Patrick Wheeler. We're back here tomorrow, 3 o'clock. Everybody, until then, stay safe, stay warm. We'll see you later.